Hello everybody, welcome everyone to this webinar hosted by Toradex entitled Secure Device Monitoring. This webinar is sponsored and presented by Toradex. My name is Renato Kies and I'm a product manager and software at Toradex. Before diving into this webinar, let me cover a few organizational topic points. Please use the chat windows of the webinar tool if you have any technical issues and let us know. At the end, we will do also interactive question and answer sessions. Can you type your questions in the chat window at any time? And we'll pick up then at the end. The webinar will be recorded and made available for on-demand viewing. With this, let's get started. What we do at Toradex, we make the embedded computing easy. Okay, we design reliable ARM system modules and also production-ready software. Okay, this gives you the lowest cost of ownership, not only having the best pricing modules, but also the best value on our modules, includes all the quality tests and the software that we also distribute together. We are industry lead. We have industry lead support and a lot of quality and also some reliable warranties. Toradex have offices spread around the world, okay, so in all main regions. Our headquarters is located in Lucerne, Switzerland, and I'm based in São Paulo, Brazil, just here in the Brazilian office. Toradex has three families of products: the Virgin, the Colibri is our oldest one, and the Apalis is our higher performance, together the Virgin. Between the families, all the SOM, all the system module are pin-to-pin compatible. So we can move back and forth between families, inside the families, and you can, for example, start with a low-end device. In case you need more performance, you move for the higher one. And you can also have the same product with two or three different flavors in performance, so you can also position your product in a different way using our pin-to-pin compatible modules. Our typical applications in market, okay, we are focused on five top markets: is industrial automation, healthcare, transportation, test and measurement, and also smart city. Our regular customer project volumes is vary from 100 up to 50,000 of pieces per project per year. Okay. Toradex also offer a wide range of software. Since the production quality be a Yocto reference image, okay, for some customers. We also offer the Linux, industrial Linux embedded distribution. We call it Torizon Core. That's based on container. We have a lot of applications ready to use and some partners application also to be included on the Torizon Core. And we have a very modern process of CI/CD, and we have our platform that we can gather data from the devices and then make the improvements in the product in basically in real time. You will see some of these parts in the coming slides. So with Torizon Core, we have fast time to market. It's open source, it's simple, it's secure. That we have simple updates, he's secure, and also he's real time. It is the real time. Okay, so let's start to the theme of our presentation. What is device monitoring? I think most of you understand well the concept, but just to do the imbalance, let me check about that. What's device monitoring? Device monitoring is basically, simply speaking, is the how to check electronic devices for health, performance, and resource usage, okay? It can be done in the application level, in the system level, and in the hardware level, device monitoring is not new. Okay, since the Industrial Revolution, basically we have this kind of device monitor, not in electronic, but in electronic as soon as the electronic was introduced in the products. Okay, but they are local. They are local device monitoring. Okay, the technicians and engineers, the maintenance crew needs to go to the site and check the equipment inside the machine. We have like a regular maintenance of the machines and the products itself, but from the devices inside the machine doing some preventive or corrective maintenance, we need very specialized person with a very specialized equipment, and they need to travel or be limited to a geographic location. It's time consuming, okay, so you need to take a longer to remove the boards, make some tests sometimes. It's change routines. In some products, you need to turn on, to turn off and on the product again to before and after the tests. It's a very low productivity. You need to do very in serialized way, okay, to not have too much people involved. And usually, you only have hardware or system level control, okay, or system level monitoring. It's hard to have the software, or it's very hard the case of the software. Now, in this trend, we are migrating to this IoT trend. We are migrating to the remote device monitoring. Okay, it's basically the theme of our presentation, and also we will support in Torizon. Remote device monitoring, we have the variables and the parameters that you have in your product or inside your device being monitored by the product itself, and also the data are sent to a remote location and then can be analyzed for a specialized person. So with this, we got a high amount of information compared with the local one. We have the self-monitoring. It's remote. It's non-invasive. Okay, you don't need to turn on the machine and remove the board. It's high productive. And we have effective software and resources monitoring also, okay, besides the hardware and system. From the productivity, is because, let's say, you still need to have someone specialized to see the master, see the errors. Less maybe than the other way, but you have the one person that can control a lot of sites, a lot of different equipment also. Okay, so now we will just release a quick pull. If you can please fill this in for us, please. We have a couple of seconds, like 5 seconds. Please, if you can answer. Oh, thank you for your answers. The most voted is in the production conception phase. You are right. Okay, the others are still right, but it's the best one to you start to working on. So let's continue the presentation. Now, when we start to use the device monitoring, okay, or basically what advantage you have of starting in any phases. During the production planning phase, it's the best to work because you define your critical points, okay? You, in a TV way, you just, during the project, you define what's your critical points and why and how you monitor that. It gives you the lowest cost to implement. So everything is there in the project. You don't just need to add software to read and add graphics, metrics, and logs for check that in their remote office. You have also the option to integrate this in the development phase. Okay, so you take advantage of the device monitoring during development phase and deploying a feature of prototype. So you can have some prototypes in field or in the lab that you easily send software, send updates, and also can monitor a lot of parameters. Don't need to be the same parameters as in production. You can even monitor more or in more frequent way because the time is less, okay? The period is less for monitoring these kind of things. You can use your boards or your devices in real condition. you can follow up very closely. And you have also the bulk data correlated with the environment and also with resources variables. So it's easier to debug. You check the error in software, and you see also the variables, the temperature, the voltage, and also what was your resources in the time of the error. How many memory, how many CPU loading. It's easier to get a hint to debug. And you can also rework software easily. We can also use the device monitoring or add device monitoring in case you do not have this yet in the update phases. So monitoring your update phases, you can use take advantage of update campaigns. For example, you start the deployment of your software in a very minimum amount of your fleet, for example, 10% of your fleet. Then you monitor critical resources, fix any misbehavior that can happen between different versions of boards or something like that, in version and not in different boards. And then you'll be confident to update all your fleet. So as soon as you deploy in this small fleet, you can test it and then update the whole fleet with a lot of confidence that we do not have any error, any issue. And then you can also use it or implement it in case you have a volume product already in your production for your production lifetime. It works on the best perceived to use this. You can keep your product working in the best perceived conditions. You can also predict upcoming issue. Okay, if your memory starts to increase and you probably have a memory leak that's unexpected, you can act. And also a very important thing, you can get your data to develop better products in the future. So you can learn if your current product, you can use the data to learn, and then you improve your next development, your next project. Some general use of the device monitoring. You can monitor your resources like RAM, flash, CPU usage, network bandwidth. And this basically you can detect memory leak, understand reboots and rings, okay, because you have more information than only the log. You can compare devices of the same fleet. You can optimize flash and disk usage and also understand the product network usage. With this, you can release new software to fix the issues just quickly. You can start a disk cleanup or adding more space, avoid recalls or plan a recall before some catastrophic failure happen. You can detect the devices too much, using too much network, okay? So you're incurring extra costs for your product and you try to fix it. Or even evaluate your internet provider quality. You can buy for the service and just check if the server is working fine. Another way to use device monitoring is to monitor sensors. So we can check some physical resources like voltage, temperature, power. With this, you can detect over temperature. You can understand reboot and run also. Okay, there are some of them are caused by under voltage or over temperature. You can check how the environment affect the power. For example, if you are working in a high temperature, probably you increase your powers, and you can also take this in charge, in account. Okay, you can measure your battery. For example, you can measure the charge and discharge rate. You can compare devices of the same fleet. With this, you can drive preventive operative maintenance, replace battery, or even send ads to your customer to buy a new battery so we can offer a new service. You can release new softwares to fix the issues, avoid recalls, yeah, the same, or dynamically calculate the expected lifetime. If you have voltage, if you have temperature, and you work for a while out of the spec, you can then reduce your expected lifetime. Or if you are always on the spec, you can also change that and knows exactly when you your device exactly or mostly exactly where your device will behave along the time. We have also the third monitor usage for software. You can monitor tasks, containers, functions. With this, you can detect delays from function or tasks. You can check if the services are running. You can monitor usage of resources by application, understand better your application crashes. And in case you have any issue, can release a new application, understand well the usage of your application, offer new features to your customer, avoid recalls, and also reduce support time and service case because you have all the data and all the tools in hand before to move to a remote support or even for a service case. With that, I point some general gain. We have more, okay? But as a standard, you can improve the overall quality and the customer satisfaction. You can reduce your time to market, focus on your application or innovation, offer new service or sell replaceable parts before the product fails. For example, you can trigger a battery selling, or you can offer to sell some bearing or sleeves to your customer. You can reduce time travel and also reduce expenses. You will not only add value to your product, but add value to your customer's application. So you take advantage of the monitor, and your customer also take advantage of this. So we have now a new pool. Okay, if you can please fill it in also. So when do you plan to use your device monitoring your product? Please give a couple of seconds to you to finish. So thanks a lot. I checked the results. So nice. Almost half of the people, the attendees, are currently use device monitors in any way. That's a very nice information and feedback. Thank you. So with this, I will start showing you a little bit about the Torizon monitoring. This is only a print screen of one of our pages. And I show you a small video, and we can discuss it later. This is the Torizon core page, is app.torizon.io. This is our login page. Just add your user. If you not have your user, just create one. Okay, and do the login. Then you have the landing for the dashboard page. In this page, you can see the overall picture of your fleets and devices. Okay, so you have the recent devices, you can provision your device, you have the recent applications and or OS, and you can add a new one and have also your fleets, and you can do the management of these fleets. Okay, you can also trigger quick updates for the devices and for the fleets. We have also the device view. In this view, you can see all the devices you have in your user account. You can also check all the packages, and you can have the fleet management. This is a new feature that we will launch soon, a very interesting, call it secure flight updates. And you can check that in the beginning or the middle of March inside our Torizon site. If with this, I will just open one device. I will open a Q102 from Brazilian fleet. Okay, we have some fleets in the office. I just open a device to show you. In this screen, you have some basic information. Okay, I just highlighted the IP because during the development, even for production, it's a very nice thing to have. Okay, the local IP of the devices, so we can use with SSH and access the boards. You have the package installed on the device, and in this case, it's a Nightly 5.6. And you have also the applications running Portainer and some extra functions. And in view detail, you can see the device monitor itself. This is the main screen for the device monitoring. You still have the information as the first screen, so the basic information for your board, the version, the status of the update. You can also initiate another control from here. And you have these four graphs: the memory usage, the CPU usage, temperature, and Docker status. This came off of the shelf with Torizon platform, okay? It's included in Torizon Core and it's included also in the platform. So as soon as you provision the board, you will check these four graphs. You can change the time window for your testing. So now I have, for example, on a week, and I have also the custom. I will just go in as soon as I activated the device. The device activated in the middle of November, so I will have like a broader window of the data. I've just clicked 15 November, and with this I can see the device for almost 4 months, okay? And all the data I gathered with that, I can see the summer in Brazil arriving. You can see the temperature, okay? It's not a controlled board. I would just highlight some no data because during this period, the board could be disconnected or could be turning off. So I just add this yellowish red line to see that during this period, I do not receive any data from the board. So the graph is interpolated and are not using real data in this region, okay? They just connected the previous and the next point. I will have other ways to do that. I just show you, okay? I only remove the highlights and I go to every graph and disconnect the points. Also, right, and click connect the point so I can see the voids, I can see the gaps, okay? So in this region, I do not have any data for any reason. I prefer to use the highlight no data region with dots connected. But there are some occasions it's better to just disconnect and I show you exactly how to do that. So this is the graphs and within the region. We have some flavors, okay, some different colors, appearance or cosmetic change. I can change for the default so we can see the colors change a little bit. You can try all of this when you access in the platform and check what is better for you or what's better for your moment. For sometimes you want one or another. And you have also this very popular, that's the dark mode. They use the same colors, but in the background, in the black background. So it's also good for highlight some data. And that's all. So we see a very brief presentation of our Torizon platform. And you move it forward for explain a little bit about the device monitoring itself. For the device monitoring, we have basically three types in the Torizon platform, in the Torizon. The first one is metric. Metric is numerical value reported at regular time intervals. It's best showing graphs is exactly what I show you right now. We can check resource usage, CPU, memory, disk, temperature, battery voltage, custom data for your application. Everything is best showing graphs. We can have also logs, okay? You can upload the real log of one or more parts of your system, like kernel logs, Docker container logs, application register or events. You see a kernel log here. It's only implementation in Torizon. It will become soon to the platform. Okay, so we still working in integration tests. And you have also the alerts. Alerts are special events or errors that the device raises and usually require attention. So the user needs to understand better and take some predefined or customized action. It's, for example, the use it for critical memory or disks, temperature of the hands, application failed to start, so we need to deploy or to reset or just trigger another container execution, something like that. And these alerts can be shown in the platform or by other means like email or any other ways to remotely report remotely alert the user. It's also an implementation in the platform and we have this kind of things very soon. In the Torizon Core and Torizon platform, we did in the past a very deep research, okay, and choose a company, the software company, the software application. We call it software agent, okay, monitoring agent that we call FluentBit. Let's call it FluentBit. FluentBit This was the chosen solution for Torizon Core. It's open source, so it's our base for defining a new software. And FluentBit is also a lightweight implementation of FluentD, okay, that's focused on embedded device. FluentD is well known for the PC, for the desktops, and also in the Linux, but it's very heavy for embedded devices. FluentBit is modular and flexible. It has around 100 plugins. It have a very active community, and it's very well documented. So it's a key feature for us is to have the documentation. You have upcoming features every day, basically, in FluentBit. So we decided to include FluentBit in our Torizon Core and Torizon platform. FluentBit has a very huge pipeline, very powerful pipeline. It's also flexible. We have some part of the pipeline, input, the parser, filter, storage, and also router. You can, in the router, you can store the data, and you can also route the data for more than one output. For example, you can send some data to the Torizon platform, and you can also send your route or regular product data. For example, you are storing some dashboards in Amazon, AWS, or in GCP, and also or in the Microsoft Azure. Okay, so you can send to the platform some data, you can send some data to some clouds, commercial cloud, and you can also send some data to both, okay, with different usage. In most of the phase, you only have three steps into three parts in your pipeline, okay? And one is input, the other is a filter, and the other one is output in destinations. Inputs are plugins to gather information and pass information from various sources. They are specialized. For example, a plugin to get data from CPU is different than a plugin that gets data from the internet, or even to read a GPIO, you can have another plugin, and they are very specialized. We have the filters. Filters allow you to modify your data before sending to a destination. You can do average, you can do maximum and minimal. You can only do some filtering, or low-pass filter, high-pass filter. You can do this kind of data treatment. Okay. You can also, and then you have also the outputs. Output are plugins to define the destination of data. Like say you can send the plugins, the routers are kind of, is a plugin now, so you can send these for different outputs. This is our FluentBit implementation on the client side, okay, in Torizon Core. They are side of our module. FluentBit itself, it's a very easy to implement. A very skilled software engineer can implement FluentBit in your device in maybe a afternoon, maybe a day. It depends on how many features you use, okay? But for Torizon, we do not have only this implementation. We implemented FluentBit in Torizon, but we need to guarantee the security of the platform. So is our key factor in the Torizon for the whole system is the security. So implemented the FluentBit data, the FluentBit to send data to the internet via a monitoring proxy. Okay, this proxy is run in the actualizer. So the actualizer are they're responsible to create a channel and send this data to the internet, to our device gateway. And inside the platform, we can treat this data, store the data, okay, and then show for the front end. It's basically, they can show and store at the same time, but we can recover the data later on. So we have the secured stuff as a key for the platform. So it's not only FluentBit, okay, it's secured FluentBit, plus some master features, and plus a lot of security, a lot of layers of security on the top of the FluentBit. How you do that and how you can get that, okay? We have our Torizon platform that's split basically in three. The one part is the hardware, so you can use the hardware that I show. Then on the top of the hardware, you have our Linux BSP. It's production grade BSP. you use the reference image to create a Torizon core. Torizon core is a Toradex distribution. It's open source. And you add more things like OS3 for the updates, extendees for the events. And we add the actualizer. It's our layer for security. And on top of this, you have the Fluent Bit, the Docker engine to run your applications in containers. Actualizer is the device side of obtaining client. Okay, this add extra security or add a lot of security to Horizon Core. And it allows you to communicate with server, manage update process, guarantee auto integrity and confidentiality. It's the same for device monitor. If you obtain actualizer at Horizon running in the obtain standard, you can guarantee also your device monitor integrity and confidentiality. So it's a lot of work we did to guarantee that. And we have the obtain. That's our open secure software update system design. It's a standard for, de facto standard for updating cars, and it's audit for security. Implemented obtaining the platform and have the actualizer on the device. So, and this, on the top of this, you have the Torizon platform services like fleet management, over-the-air updates, remote access, device monitoring, and everything you are seeing here are off the shelf. So if you get Torizon Core, you have this up and running. If you sign in for the platform, you can use some of these features. If you sign in for, if you have the pay subscription, you can then basically work with everything in the platform. Now I just show you quickly how to do some custom metrics for your project, because most of you do not want to read only CPU or only resources. You have also the possibility to check your real parameters. So I would just run a quick video to show you how to do that. Just complimenting before that. We use, and basically all metrics can be added. There's a plenty of the plugins that you can use, so you can check the Fluent Bit documentation or even the developer website in Toradex to get more detailed documentation. And what we decided to implement this customized data, sending them via localhost. So the data do not go outside the SOC, it's okay, so it's logically routed inside the chip and is not exposed to the internet. And you can read the data and send then this data via normal ways, via actualizer, with a lot of security. And these changes do not have any impact on our security. Here I just add a new metric, okay, a customized metric. These are the four ones that came off the shelf of the platform. I add one that was not off the shelf. I'll show you later how to include this. It's a Ethernet RX. Okay, it's not percent, so you put as a byte. I will remove the maximum so they'll be out scale. You can do some parsing. Okay, I have some defining some to megabytes or to Celsius. You can change that. And I look for RX message metrics. I will choose to have the bytes. It's better to show, okay. I can add a label to make it easy to understand. So it is 0RX. And just click save the change. It will add a new graphic, very easily a new graph to your platform. Okay, it's a metric that I implemented for a while only. Okay, it's showing the data the platform receive. I only trigger a wget command, okay, to show you. I'm downloading a 1 meg. Okay, it's a 1 megabyte package. And this is the Fluent Bit config file. Okay, it's a standard one with exception of this. I just add a custom metric here. So I send data to the in a local port in the local host, and I call this custom. Okay. With this custom, I add the net. I use a net plugin, Okay, it's called a NetIF, it's a default plugin for the Flint Beat. I choose 60 seconds for update timing, and it's aggregator data for Internet Zero. And I send and nest this under the custom data. So I receive this as a custom data. As you can see that, we receive a new package of 1 meg, okay, just after the 2 p.m. And you add right now some other graphs just to highlight some other features. Okay, I will try to split CPU load into the system and user. The first one is system. I'm using a IDOMX 8 QM. So we have six CPUs. Okay. I put all down as a system. So in this graph, you can see how the CPU are running the operational system, the kernel, and other things. And I add also the user. You can add, for example, more graphs splitting. In the IDOMX 8, you have 2 cores of A72 and 4 cores of A53. You can split even then. You can add more graphs splitting this if it's important for your application. So you can have a lot of flexibility. The order you include is basically the order that appears on the screen. Okay. So just to be aware of that. And now you can see the 7 graphs, the 3 new ones, okay, with the new package I receive. They split it in the processor in a very beautiful way. I will show for you at the end one example. Okay, it's the temperature monitor example. It's for doing this, I used some boards I have in my home office. Okay, it's a 2 Colibris IDOMX 7D. With 1 gig, running the same OS and the same application. The board A is the 7 and the /2 on video, okay? Has enclosure in a case with normal conditions. And the board B has enclosed with vents blocked. So I just put some tapes on the vents to avoid heat change between the room and the board. And these boards are in the same room and they belong to the same fleet. Okay, so basically I try to simulate a real condition in the field. Sorry, I create a fleet with 2 devices. The device 1 is the device I block the vents, and device 2 is the device that I leave the case with thermal exchange with the heat exchange with the room. Okay, so I move to the board 2. Is our A board for the example. Here I have the information, okay, both are 7D. They are running the same application. Okay, it's a container with a stress test. They are in the same version of the OS. They were running the quarterly Torizon 5.5. And I check the details for the first board. As you can see, the CPU loads, okay, are very low for this time period. And they are the same for the other board, okay? So we can check the temperatures around, if no load, is around 5.4, 5.7 Celsius degrees. Okay, I will just open a little bit the timing for 1 day. So we can see with CPU running at 100%, okay, the 2 CPU are running full. I have increase in the temperature that goes about around 53. So there are some variation and you can see this. I will show You now the second board, okay, the board B. This board have the same version, the 7D with the same OS version, and the same Docker compose you use. You're running the stress test. With no load, okay, you have an increase in the temperature about 5-6 degrees. If I move to 1 day, you have a 100% load in the CPU, you see that this board reached like 64 because do not have any exchange, any heat exchange with the room. So the temperature is higher than the same board as lying in the side. Okay, so you can see the difference of this. Okay, it's also varied along the day because I'm not a controlled room. Okay, I just try to simulate something internal but not controlled. Just going back to the other board to you see the difference. I captured that also in the picture. So we have like 73. So around 10 to 11 Celsius degree of delta between these two boards. This is the normal boards, okay, the normal enclosure. We reach about 55 degrees on the maximum for this board. And the same board with the vents closed, we have like 65 degrees. Okay, why it's important this kind of for me? What's this information important? Because in the field, probably you do not have control of your product. And you have dust that are blocking your vents, and that the temperature starts to increase slowly. Okay, with this increase, for example, very slowly, you can check and determine that it's probably dust that are tying through your vents and block them. Or if you use a case fan, for example, and the case fan stops to work, you see a very high increase in the temperature. And so we need to trigger a maintenance. You can also have someone that just put a book on the top of your product or enclosure your product in a furniture and do not allow any exchange in temperature, any heat exchange. So it's a well common issue that you can see in the field, okay? The user or the environment enacting to impart your product. And you can see in this presentation. Colibri 7D is a low power SOM, so it's probably not the best one to show this temperature difference. Okay, it's well above the allowed range. But I do a quick simulation with one of our IdleMax 8X QM. You can see that in QM, you have like a normal user here. Then this pointer, you have a normal user here. Then I block the vents of the case. You see the temperature is slowly increasing, reaching the maximum at 87.9. And then I remove the vents, okay? I remove the stress test here, okay? I run in the stress test and I just create a block of the vents and leave the stress test running. And then I just stop the stress test and the board stays at higher temperature because they do not have any exchange with the ambient. Probably during the day, if it passes more time, they will decrease slowly, okay? But for this example, I do not have. So the ZDMX have the enclosure vents blocked. You can see you reach a very high temperature here. Why it's important? Okay, I show you only two graphs here. This is the graphs for the ZDMX 8Q. Okay, 8Q do not have commercial certification. They have industrial and automotive. So for most of the applications in Toradex is important to highlight the commercial and the industrial, our IT. So I just used the one for the Dead.maxm, okay, that I have in the family, in the Verdin family. And for the queue is basically the same. You can just check this application note, you see that the temperature is basically the same. And we have two graphs. One is for commercial, okay? You have the temperature here, you have the number of power hours that your product will last if you run in that temperature range. Temperature and voltage, okay? You have also voltage. So in a short table here, if you run the CPU speed at 1.5 gigahertz and using 1.05 voltage, okay, in industrial, in a commercial temperature, you can reach a maximum of 24K, 22K of power hours. If you just reduce the voltage, we will run at 48K power hours, okay? But for example, as soon as it's a project definition, if you decide to use in 1.5, for example, you have this amount of power, the minimum at 95, but as soon as you decrease the temperature, you will increase the power on hours. So even in the worst case with 1.5 volts, you can work, for example, in an 8 Celsius degree and have like 50,000 hours, 50,000 power hours in your product. So you, if you're working in a very hot environment, you pay a penalty for this in the lifetime, okay, in the reliability. If you choose to use the industrial temperature that most of the case is necessary, you have the same table. You do not have the same core performance. It's a little bit smaller, like 1.3 gig for one test, and use the same 1.105 volts. You have 29, almost 30,000 power on hours instead of 21. And also you have in 1.0 volts, 64, okay, so it's too much, too more than in the commercial. You have also the possibility to decrease a little bit the, not a little bit, but decrease the frequency. And you have, in this case, like 3,000K, 300K of power hours, okay, with a lower voltage also. It's another extreme. But if you just check the worst one, you see you have this graph here, and you see the temperature. For example, in our case, if I check reaching like 87 degrees, in my application, I have a room temperature around 35 degrees. So in the industrial environment, the temperature is higher. So the heat is also be higher. So we can have like 37 here, and you have around 80K power on hours. If I decrease a little bit the temperature, I will reach easily like 200K hours. Okay, so the temperature play a very important role in your lifetime. With the dynamic and with the monitor, with the dynamic calculations, you can use, for example, your product when you need more performance. You just leave your product running at higher speed, and then you can reach like 100 Celsius degree for a while. And then when you don't need, you just reduce and working in 80. And then you can dynamically calculate this lifetime. So if you run for 10 hours in the very high, like close to die temperature, you will decrease the hours. But if you run here, you increase, and you can sum this amount of hours and calculate dynamically your product lifetime, expected lifetime. Okay, so it's a very important thing. So over temperature, impact your system performance and reliability, as you see in the graphics. I'm showing only the CPU, the SoC. And for most of you, it's not the most critical part of your project. During your design, your carrier board, you need to take that in consideration for all and components in your product, okay? You can reduce the product lifetime. You can reduce the mean time between fails. You can increase the noise of moving parts like a bearing, a motor, a fan. you can decrease the hardness of some plastics or other components. You can increase or reduce mechanical gaps. You can that can bend your make voids. Okay, so the overall appearance could be impaired. And the worst, you can also lose the guarantee. If you reach a very high temperature and the equipment not projected to do that, you possibly lost the warranty. Okay, so that's I have for now for device monitor. We will have now our Q&A sections. If you can fill out the chat with the questions, please, I will be here for a couple of minutes to answer that. Please, anytime. The first question I received is Torizon only supported for Toradex devices, or it's supported available for other devices? Currently, it's supported only for Toradex devices. Okay, we did the support for this, but Torizon is open source. So in case you have one device that you want to port to Torizon, or to use with Torizon, you can grab the Torizon and have your kernel, basically it's your base kernel, and move to import Torizon to your application, to your product. And with that, you take advantage of all the features included in Torizon, like the obtain, the actualizer, the Fluent Beat, and all the security and quality for your product. Okay, so it's not now supported. Okay, we did not did it, but we are strictly tied to open source solutions. So we can just go to the Toradex website, grab the source code. Torizon is provided as a Yocto receipt. So we can change the receipt and do your port for your product. Okay. One other question, how often can I send my metrics data to the platform? There's no rule of thumb, okay? There's no strict restriction on this. But remember, this is health monitoring. So you need to send basically the data you do for this kind of health monitoring. For example, compare with the humans, okay? If you are... you have higher pressure, blood pressure, you sometimes need to trigger or check that three times in a day. If you have diabetes, you need to measure your level of sugar or blood sugar like once a day or twice a day. It's the same for the equipment, okay? If in the humans, if you like take your pressure a lot of times in the day, probably it's not, you don't need that. You need that only in regular exams like a router or something like that. So you can take more frequent measures. For the devices, the same. For example, temperature, you can read temperatures of about half an hour. And for CPU resources, you can read this like a 3-5 minutes. So it's need to check what makes sense for you. What do not make sense is to send data for example, every 1 second. Okay, for the health monitoring. Maybe for some very critical debugging issue, you can do this kind of thing, but not for the overall usage. Okay, so I think the same. I have a data logger project. Can I use Torizon to store and show the data I get? Theoretically, you can, but it's not Torizon device monitoring was not done for this kind of thing, okay? It's intended to do the health monitoring, so and the data for the data log probably will reach a frequency too high for our standards, and you start to put too much data on the platform, and there are probably in the future we have some restrictions on it for some special plans. And the best way to you send your device logger data is split into, for example, what's your product intention, what's your product dashboard data, and send this data to a cloud provider that are willing to receive this kind of data. Okay, they are prepared to receive this high amount of IoT data. And for the Torizon, you concentrate the health and the monitoring data. So you have the data logger flowing via Fluent Bits to GCP or Azure or AWS, and the device data, the device health data and resources data go into the platform in a very easy way, in a very well-defined way to control the health of the system. Over what interfaces the devices are communicating with Torizon? You define, basically, you need to have internet access to communicate with the Torizon. I mean, here it's Torizon platform. Okay, for the Torizon platform, we need internet access. So if your module have internet, you can use that. The Ethernet is for it. If you do not have, but you have the Wi-Fi, you can use Wi-Fi. You have an external dongle, you can use this external dongle. So I think Torizon platform is agnostic about the interface. We need only a high-speed interface with the capability to send data to the internet. Okay, it's not a local network, it's a real outside or internet. Is it possible to download the data I'm seeing in the graphics? It's not possible today, okay? We can download it internally in the test mode. We are doing the integration of this feature, but it will be possible soon. We probably will have some different data plans for download the data. Okay, so check our website in the future or talk to your sales representative so you can have a clear picture about what kind of data you can download or what kind of amount of data you can download. But for sure, we store this data inside our platform, and this data will be available for you in case you need to plot a graphic or to show to someone or do some maths on top of it. Okay. What operating systems are support on this device? Limited because of the support of OS for Fluent Bits. Okay, for this application, for device monitoring and also for the OTA, we are tied with the Torizon Core. Okay, so it's our industrial Linux embedded system, okay, operational system. And we use Torizon Core for this. So Fluent Bits use are tied to the Torizon Core. You can do it in other systems, but you need to port the actualizer, you need to port the OS3 for the OTA updates. So for you to take the most advantage off the shelf, I highly recommend you to try to use Torizon. Torizon is working nicely, smoothly with our boards, and you can have the best experience in your quick start, booting your board, checking the operational system, and then do the provision and then move for the platform with all the servers you can support. Okay. Is it possible to install monitoring platform to customer servers? Some customers have closed network, no internet connection for security reasons. Yes, it would be possible. Okay, we are also implementing or just doing the public API for our system. We have this working right now. And we will provide a public API, so we will integrate your API in your server. Okay, this server must be accessed to the internet. Okay, not the local network, but we need to create a bridge or create a server or at least a path to go to and connect to our platform. We will store the data in the platform, we control everything in the platform, and using the API, you can get this data and show the data in your server. So the devices send data to your server, so your server routes to the platform, and the same for graphics, you can check. In this case, I think for graphics, it's better to use the platform directly or create your own site and with the data, you can use some graphical tools and show the data, but it will be possible to you to use outside this. I just guys, quickly remind here, if I answer your question, but it's not fully clear, please just ask again or just rephrase it so I can work on a better answer for you, okay? Or in case you do not have time here, just ping me or just send a message for your sales partner of Toradex, and we can for sure answer you in detail, okay? So a couple of minutes, if you have any other question, just let me know. Okay, no? So I think we are done. Thanks a lot for your participation. This webinar will be available on demand after a couple of days. You can check that later. And anytime, just contact us in Toradex, myself and Toradex. Thank you a lot for the participation, and enjoy to see you using the platform, the Torizon Core, the platform, and more specifically the device monitoring. If you have any feedback of usage, just let me know, okay? We are open to feedbacks, we are open to new features, we can deal with these kind of things very, very easily. We are on the MVP phase, so any new feature is the right moment for you to include in the final product. So thank you all. Have a very nice day, and bye-bye.